us about entrepreneurship in prisons.
Okay, thank you.
Hi.
And thank you for making it so difficult for me to put mine after such a wonderful presentation. So you certainly set the bar really high. I've got a few slides that I'd like to share. Is that possible through my sharing?
You should be able
yes,
to
go ahead.
Your sharing. Yeah.
Yes. Let me see. Is that sharing? Am I sharing here?
Not yet.
Not quite.
Let me see then. Let me see how I can do this then. Let me see. Sorry about this.
That's no problem, Ruth. There's a little square with an arrow pointing up. That's what you want to click, and then have your slide.
Right, I've got a share tray. That's right.
Yes, this sounds right. And then select your presentation from there. Great.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's coming up.
You've got it. Yes.
It's blank.
All right.
What you need to do, Ruth, is if you open up your presentation ready.
Yeah, which is what I did actually. Let me see.
Okay.
Let me see. I'll open it up, then I'll go back. Okay. Then I'll go back to the. Sorry about this. Right.
No worry at all.
Right. And it's saying stop sharing, so it's almost like I'm doing it right. Let me have a look.
There we go. Great.
Have we got it now?
Yep.
Yes.
Yep.
You should have the first slide there. Unlocking potential. Is that right?
Yeah.
Great. That's fantastic. Right. Okay. Well, my name's Ruth Lowbridge, and I'm executive chair of the sfedi Group. Which is made up of the with a sector skills body for enterprise and enterprise support, which means that we research and set national occupational standards, which sit behind a lot of the skills, the qualification offers that you see out there. We also, as part of our group, have the Institute of Enterprise and Entrepreneurs, which is approved by the Secretary of State. We have over 35,000 members that are made up of business owners and also the people that support those small and micro businesses. And these are advisors, coaches and mentors. But what I'm going to be talking about today is work that we've been doing both with our standards, but also through our awarding organisation, sfedi Awards. And we have over 250 centres throughout the UK, all delivering enterprise related qualifications. And some of that work is within the prisons. So what I'm going to just talk through is this work that has resulted in developing a qualification offer to offenders. So first of all, I'd like to introduce you to Maggie. And Maggie actually is self-employed, and she has a number of skills which are all around spotting opportunities, being very creative, mobilising others. She has vision for the future of her business. She values ideas, and also she mobilises resources. She's very financially savvy, and she often has to cope with uncertainty and ambiguity and risk. She plans and she manages her business, and she works with others, and she learns through her own experiences. Now, at this point, if I had a live audience, I would normally ask the question, what kind of business do you think Maggie runs? Well, I know it's difficult to get feedback at this stage, but it's really interesting to think about Maggie and all of the wonderful skills and attributes that she has. So you usually get guesses like maybe she runs her own business, maybe she has a caring business, maybe she has a shop, but nobody normally would think about the business that she operates. And her business operates against this background. And again, what I normally do is I normally ask people, well, there's the background. That's almost her operating environment. What do you think that she does? Well, actually, Maggie's a drug dealer. And Maggie, for her sins, was actually caught drug dealing and she went into a prison. Now, within that prison, this was about thinking about, well, Maggie, when you come out of prison, maybe we want you to think about some of those transferable skills that you have, because she ran a very successful business. Unfortunately, her business was in the black market. And therefore, we started to think about some of those attributes that she had, some of those skills that she had. And as you see, as you look around there, you'll see that, and you probably recognise those as entrepreneurial skills. I would certainly hope that, being in business myself for over 25 years, I actually have some, maybe not all of those skills, but certainly a large number of them. The couple of things that she didn't have there was the idea that she should be ethically and sustainable in her thinking when running her business. And also, there wasn't an awful lot of self-awareness and self-efficacy. So those are the things that we started to think about bringing out whilst she was in the offending institute. And we worked with a partner who had a funding contract directly from government and helped them to help her to actually learn what she needed to do to take her skills and her ambition out into the world when she finished her sentence. So what Maggie did was she actually opened a coffee shop, and she now runs, actually this is a real person, and she runs a very successful coffee shop. And she's been very keen to share her experiences with us. And often through our events, what we do is we invite people who have gone through our programmes and have found a light at the end of the tunnel, as it were, as they come out and come through the gate. So this work was all built on the Coates Review. And as some of you may know, Dame Sally Coates highlighted the importance of self-employment as a key route for offenders, where the nature of their offending may take them, will make them unsuitable or unlikely to get jobs with employers. And we find this a lot with the people, particularly young people that we work with. We find that often once they're offended, then it's really difficult for them to find jobs when they actually come out of prison. So she also said that improving the prison education can transform individual prisoners' lives and also benefit society. And this, again, this is one of the things that we've seen over and over again, where lives have been transformed by thinking about some of the skills that they already had, some of these entrepreneurial skills, and how they could actually use them in the outside world. So the next few slides are really just about the journey that we take our offenders through. Well, first of all, what we did was we developed a number of enterprise resources, and these are little workbooks, they're videos, and they're all based on a qualification that we developed, and they were made available through the virtual campus. And this is something that prisoners can access in whilst they're inside. But what we try to do is link it with the things that they can actually access when they come through the gate. We piloted some self-employment focused qualifications in two prisons in the Northwest. And then we developed a level one and a level three programme, which was a progression through different pathways. And this made sure that we made the best of funding as well as provided the best route for the learner. So the next part of the journey was expanding that self-employment qualification and making sure that we were looking at things like personal development and social development. So it wasn't just about self-employment and it wasn't just about starting a business, but it was helping them to be more employable. We were included within the EU Commission's best practice guide for sharing ideas of how to integrate standards, which are the things that sit behind all of this, into learning and qualifications. And we've had well over now 10,000 people through our SFEDI Awards learner qualifications. So this is the enterprise pathway. As there is a prison induction, and this supports individuals to understand how the regime operates. And then what we do is we focus on the development of self-confidence and self-belief before we start thinking about any of those practical skills. So that's linked into our level one passport to enterprise and employment. It's got lots of elements in that and very much a pick and mix. And they can then move on to the level two and then along to the level three. It was interesting in the last presentation when we talked about mentoring and how important that is for the group of individuals that you were talking about, because we find that mentoring is absolutely key to this. And this is not just mentoring whilst they're in prison, but also as they come through the gate. And we work with organisations like Tony and Guy, for instance, some of the major banks, Lloyds Bank in particularly, who actually are happy to go into prisons and offer mentoring whilst they're in prison. But this also means that as they move through the gate, they have somebody that they know that they can speak to when moving through their enterprise learning journey. But they can't see an audience. It's really difficult to know whether this is going down well or not. So I'm hoping that it is, and I only have a few more slides now.
I'm going to give you some really positive feedback. This is great, Ruth.
All right, that's great.
It is really good.
It's really hard, isn't it? You know, when you haven't got an audience to look at. This is the prisoner view then. We obviously did some research and we found that prisoners who felt that self-employment was an important option for ex-offenders, and some of them hadn't thought about it before. And it was very much linking, you know, you've got the skills, you've been doing things outside. They're very innovative. You know, they're the most innovative. They have all of the skills, those entrepreneurial skills, and it was really just about redirecting the view of their own skills and putting them into something where they were doing it legally. Prisoners who believe development of enterprise behaviours, knowledge and skills will support in day-to-day life. So it wasn't just about running their own businesses, but it was about how could those skills help them to be more employable. The prisoners who believe that development of enterprise behaviours, knowledge and skills will support them into self-employment, 95% said they thought that they would, and 81% thought that it would also be good to help them in sustainable employment. And a nice one for us, 94% of prisoners would recommend enterprise qualifications to others. And then just a few words really from prisoners themselves. And I'll allow you to read those for yourselves. But I think what you see there is a real passion from the prisoners in doing something different, I think, whilst they were inside. And also thinking about how they could actually use those skills, but put them to better use. And then from the delivery staff view, because we thought it was really important that actually the people who were delivering this were engaged, were motivated, were bought into the idea of developing these really important entrepreneurial skills. And we found from the delivery staff that they're always really keen to get involved in this, because normally within a prison, as you probably know, there is a focus on literacy and numeracy, which is obviously really important. But for delivery staff, this gave them something different. The resources were very different, they were very lively. We aim to be very user-friendly in what we do. And at the moment, what we're doing is, obviously, a lot of our prison centres are closed down, and therefore we're making everything virtual, and the delivery staff are working really hard to make sure that we make the resources accessible to everyone. The other thing that's really important for us is that we link it with our professional institute, the Institute of Enterprise and Entrepreneurs. And whilst in prison, they obviously can't access our learning zone, which is the campus, because they don't get access to the World Wide Web. But what we have done is we've worked with central government to make sure that where possible, we get everything on what they call the virtual campus. And this is the virtual campus that they can access whilst inside. That means that when they come outside, they'll see something very similar within our IOE campus. And we give all of our learners 12 months free studying membership of IOEE. And that's deferred for prisoners, so they can access, and that 12 months starts on the day of release, which means that they can access all of these additional resources, but also they're recognisable because they will have already seen something very similar whilst inside on the virtual campus. So, were there any questions on that? Close this down now. Again, I can share these slides and any other of any more of our research that anyone would find interesting.
Thank you, Ruth. That was great. We will we'd love to share the slides with people today and put them in the members area at ERSA. I've also got a request that it'd be really good to have a session on this at our Justice and Rehabilitation Forum. But I can see two people with their hands raised. So shall we bring it on? Oh, three people with their hands raised. Can I bring in Fiona Barrett first?
Hi there. Thank you. Thanks, Ruth. I'm from Genius Within, and we support neurodiverse prisoners on the CFO3 project. I'm also part of the Offender Forum, so it would be fantastic actually if you could come along and share that research. I just kind of wanted to say thank you, and also just to note that for us, placing people into employment, which is one of our aims, we really find that self-employment is a great route forward for people, and it ties in also with what Amanda was saying just regarding sort of that specialist thinker and entrepreneurial skills. So it was just to say thank you, to acknowledge that, and to say, yeah, if I could get a copy of that research, that would be wonderful.
Right. Yeah.
Great. Thank you very much.
Shall I do that through? Who would I send that research?
If you sent it to Laura, so Laura Benfield, she will send it. She can forward it on. We're struggling with the meeting chat. We've no idea why. Two other hands raised, Lizzie Bond.
Hi, yeah, thank you so much. That was really interesting. I only caught the tail end. I had a meeting with DWP, but in Devon, we've got three prisons, and we're working closely with the checkout lounge and departure lounge, and that's where we meet prisoners up to 12 weeks before point of release to talk about what they need and their thoughts. And I completely agree with you. Social enterprise is something which comes up a lot. So I was very interested in your talk, and obviously, like all the research as well, it ties in exactly with our ethos to get people through the gate and to an interview within 24 hours, wherever possible, so we don't have that sort of drop-off rate. So thank you so much. Very interesting.
Okay. Thank you, Lizzie. And Janita? Hello? I think we've got a bit of a connectivity problem here. No, I don't think we've got our other question. Perhaps we can pick this up offline. So thank you so much, Ruth. I definitely want to invite you to do another session with ERSA. I think there's another conversation with sfedi we should be having, so I'd like to connect with you after this. And I think we're probably at the point where it's time to just close this session and to move on to the session we've got with Dr. Isla Kapasa. Thank you very much.